Hey y'all, this episode is actually going to run a little long. I didn't want to cut it off because there's so much good material covered in here. Also, we have several different discount codes and coupons and gifts for you, so I hope you listen to the entire thing. We have new podcasts coming out that have discount codes. We have discount codes for this episode's interview, and we also have our sponsorship discount. So please listen in, listen closely. All of the information will also be in the show notes for the episode. And yeah, enjoy the show.
Welcome to the Medical Minimus Podcast, your source for memory techniques and accelerated learning in higher education. Now, here's your host, Chase DeMarco.
Many students struggle when they begin making their own visual markers. They want examples created by others to guide them and spark their own creativity. Well, today we have Drs. Bryan and Aaron Lemieux from Sketchy Medical here to discuss how they went about making their visuals to provide tips and mistakes to be aware of. Sketchy Medical started in 2015 and has been a sensational hit amongst first and second year medical students. I'm grateful to be able to have two of the leading team members here to explain why. The Brothers Lemiux, I'm so glad you could join today.
Hello, yeah. It's awesome to be here. Thanks for inviting us.
So, a little bit about you two, besides being twin brothers and one of you being one of the co-founders and the other chief content creator, was it?
Yeah, somewhat. We don't really know what he does. Okay. Yeah.
One
he
of
has
those
his own titles. Office.
We don't do titles here. It's like, you know, conductor and like, you know, caboose guy or something.
Gotcha. And you always got to toss a brother a, you know, a title anyway, make him feel
special. Exactly. You just got to throw him a bone every once in a while.
I'm actually the older brother. I'm the older twin, so the roles are a little reversed, but I usually do everything about 20 minutes.
It's just biology.
20 minutes ahead? All right. I'm not sure if we cut out there, so in case the audience couldn't hear that, I believe you said 20 minutes ahead?
Oh, yeah. I'll do something first. And then he'll just immediately copy me because, you know, he's the younger brother. It's kind of the role that he fulfills.
Gotcha.
Anyway, this is Bryan speaking, and I can introduce myself really quickly. So I actually graduated from medical school in 2016, which is kind of recent, but it feels forever ago now that I've been full-time working with and for Sketchy and for all of you guys since opening up our office in LA. And the other two co-founders, Andrew and Saud, they're off doing their emergency medical residencies in Northwestern University and George Washington University. And they'll be rejoining soon. And Aaron, my twin brother, graduated from medical school also in 2016. He went to UC San Diego. I went to UC Irvine. And I kind of roped him in because he's an artist and he had some awesome ideas. So now he's the chief
officer,
content and creative.
This is the practice we opened up instead. So
right.
The company was really starting to take off while we were both still in medical school. It started with just posting a few videos on YouTube. The response was huge, and it just really gave us the drive to make a complete microbiology course. And this is all while we were still in med school, so it involved a lot of planning, a lot of not sleeping on top of already not sleeping, a lot of moving some rotations around here and there. And then the big next project was the pharmacology course, which was created also before we even graduated from medical school.
Yeah.
So we both did take a research year off that was a lot of research and a lot of just working on sketchy material.
Don't tell our PIs.
And then by the time we graduated, we did not go into the match, and instead we opened up this office in Los Angeles next to where Bryan's then fiance, now wife, is completing her residency, and while the other co-founders are completing their residencies currently.
Yeah, and then once we opened up our office in LA, we could just get down to business, and we started churning out new features on the website. New ways to interact with the material.
Getting down to business.
Whole new courses. So that's when we released pathology was in our LA office. And last December, we released our first step two course, internal medicine.
Woo!
Oh, so nice.
We have our foot in the door now with our more clinical aspect of the way we can use our products. So we're going all out and creating new clinical courses this year. It's going to be great and hope everyone's excited.
Wow. Yeah,
the biggest way we're building the company and really building our style was starting with something that was easily broken up into chunks and relied a lot on memorization, which is microbiology. Moving on to pharmacology, which you sprinkle in a little actual physiology and mechanism. And then once you get to pathology, it's a lot of mechanism, cause and effect, grouping ideas together. And it's just really getting more and more creative with our style and still fitting it into an illustration.
And the courses definitely got harder and harder to make.
Oh, definitely.
And you can imagine for the more clinically oriented courses, it's less rote memorization and more process thinking. How should I think about this patient? How do I organize my thoughts? But we've totally developed some sort of visual system that helps you organize your thoughts for more clinical thinking.
Yeah.
So the style is different from internal medicine pictures and videos, but when people give it a try, it can kind of get the hang of it. It's really fun, and it, you know, it's helpful for the wards. It's helpful for the shelf exams, helpful for step two, just to have this cool visual kind of like memory map that you can go back to. So yeah, we're just trying to build more and more for these clinical courses.
Wow, that's really cool. And, you know, a lot of people say that, at least surveys I see with students, is a lot of them say they want to go into some sort of academic medicine and teaching at some point, and very few do. And I feel like medicine education is really lacking in certain areas because not enough people take the time to do that. So congrats on being able to do so and being so successful in it.
Yeah. The thing that we think about is that, you know, Socrates, when he was, you know, standing up there doing his thing, all he was missing was a PowerPoint. He would have totally used PowerPoint. PowerPoint, we think, has been around for like a few decades. You know, it's like, let's face it, it's PowerPoint has been around for like millennia, the idea of PowerPoint.
Right.
And to transition to an actual interactive creative style is something that required a lot of hard work and a lot of creativity and a lot of thinking outside the box. But it's also what drives us because of how we get to actually make a big difference and how we get to do something no one's ever done before. And to think of always be thinking of new ways to apply to something else and start changing something else.
Yeah. So we're trying. It's tough, but we're having fun and we're trying.
Well, having fun is half of it at least. Now, it's probably a majority of it. You got to have fun and enjoy what you're doing in order to keep up with the busy schedules and deadlines and all the other unforeseen circumstances that arise.
Yeah, definitely.
So when it comes to your style of visual markers, is there anything that you've noticed you did differently, or where did you learn this to begin with?
Yeah, so it's really funny. It kind of came naturally for microbiology. Each microbe already just seems like a main character with like superpowers, or it's like a cowboy with his like posse, or just like, you know, just like some main character that's interacting with the world.
A sea god in a urinal. you know, the usual stuff.
So I actually already kind of was drawing this on the side of my notebook, and I printed out all my PowerPoint slides because I'm a sucker for just like a regular old pen and pencil, so I can do little sketches on the side. And I was already kind of doodling, and Francisella was like St. Francis, and Bartonella was Bart the Cat, and I had all these wacky characters I was creating. So it kind of just came naturally because it's so hard to compartmentalize everything, especially for microbiology, and there's a lot of rote memorization. So it came naturally to me as an artist to just do that as tiny doodles on the side. To go the next step and to create actual worlds with other interacting characters, I never even would have dreamed of. I kind of thought I'd reached my peak, but it kind of took, we had to all kind of join our minds together to be like, this is awesome. How do we show this to other people, and how do we make it better? So it was kind of just an extension of what I naturally already did. I took the information I was already trying to compartmentalize, and I just turned it into little doodles on the side of the page.
Oh, that's awesome. So in a lot of our past episodes, we've interviewed people like memory champions and asked their techniques on how they make visual markers, but we haven't really gotten it from an artistic side of view, as I think you're more able to kind of give us that side and how you started producing some of these types of visuals. So I'm curious, is there anything in particular that maybe students could practice or look into to develop their own skills at creating these types of visuals?
Yeah, totally. First of all, like, trust your visual and creative instincts. Like, I think a lot of people get too hard on themselves because they don't think they know how to draw, or they don't think that a stick figure on the side of their notes is worth the time. But you'll be totally surprised by, if you draw a stick figure and if the little sword you put in his hand means the same thing each time, like, you can totally use that to your advantage. Some of my friends in medical school, I feel so sad because I didn't get to use Sketchy Medical because I had to, like, I was halfway done with the micro course, I think, when I took my step one, and it's totally awesome. I was like, I'm so glad I made these videos. But my friends were already using some of these techniques, and they would print out like a Picasso painting and assign each of like the features on this woman's face to a different pathology. And they'd like put a bird on her shoulder for like a like something else. And so even if you can't do it yourself, like, there are also other ways you can do it. Like, print out some cool, like, whatever your favorite painting is, whatever your favorite moving is, like, print out a scene from it and just like assign topics to that character in your favorite movie. And it's super helpful and it's really fun. And it's kind of makes the scene unforgettable. I mean, you can super, super simplify too. Something else I did was, I would, like, if there was some like cardiac side effect on my pharmacology slides, I'd underline it in red. So when like I glance, or and if there was like a musculoskeletal side effect, I'd underline it in orange. Like, I picked colors that I associate with organ systems. So I could like quickly flip through my notes and I see different colors and like jump out to me like which organ systems are affected. Like, there are totally a bunch of different ways you can use color and characters to your advantage. And then everyone knows, it's no secret that first aid is really popular and everyone gets one before studying for step one. And everyone annotates it. Like, every page is just like filled from margin to margin with like tiny little letters. I recommend at least totally color coding them so that if it's about a certain organ system, you can do a different color. But yeah, it's, like, med school is not easy, and we're not here to like make it like a breeze. But if it's more fun and more enjoyable and more visual, like, that in itself is just like totally worth it. So you can like take the time, struggle, learn all the info, but have a good time doing it. Like, that's kind of the goal here.
Yeah. It seems like you could take an entire page of some materials such as first aid and make a drawing for just that one whole page and fit in several different important parts,
exactly.
Which is much easier to remember, recall that one drawing, especially if you put in like a memory palette or something later on, than trying to remember all of the 50 different facts on each page.
Yeah, totally. And I'm a little biased towards visuals because I kind of grew up drawing like superheroes and cartoon characters when I was little. So it totally worked for me. But like I was saying before, even if you don't think you're a visual learner, just try it. Like, it's fun. And I think you'll get a lot of, I think you'll realize you're more of a visual learner than you thought you were.
Yeah, my stick figures are amazing.
Like, you're pretty much a professional artist.
All right. So another thing I love to ask, especially educators about, is what are some of the obstacles that you've seen students complain about before or run into, and maybe some of the ways to overcome those obstacles?
I think some of the obstacles relate to the amount of information. And I think even though it's easy to say, oh, okay, well, we'll take this section and we will turn it into a drawing, an interactive drawing, and we'll go around this scene. A lot of information is still a lot of information. And sometimes the best way to compartmentalize that information into different folders in your brain becomes that much more important when there's just an overwhelming amount, and that it's not necessarily all belongs in the same place, and that it get broken up and be given different themes, and you can even go over them at different times, and it doesn't have to be overwhelming if you break it down. You try to turn it into little mini stories instead of one big story that's overwhelming.
Mm-hmm. I think another big roadblock that unfortunately is not something that's going to change for reaching the choir right now, but learning for the boards in step one, which is super, super important, versus learning for the class to do well and like what your professor wants you to know, which is cool too, because they have a lot of real world experience. It's just hard to balance both, and you don't want to miss out on, like, if you study one way, you feel like you're missing out on the other way. I mean, so that's why it's cool when there are other resources out there which is what we're working on, to make studying for the boards with little tidbits for class faster, more efficient, and more fun, so that you can try to balance both of those, because it's tough. Like, God, I want to memorize every single slide, but, and I'll get like 1 point higher in my exam, and now I don't have as much time to study stuff that's actually going to be on this other huge test called the USMLE Step 1. So yeah. It's tough, and I do not know the answer. Like, it's always going to be this tough, like, tug and pull in different directions.
That's a good point. There's a great variation in certain classes and certain professors and what they teach. And take biochemistry, for instance, you know, in what you learn in class is a very, very small part of what you're going to need on the exam, but
exactly. Mm-hmm.
You still have to pass those exams first to get past that class. So
yeah, mm-hmm.
I guess there might be some different techniques for more long-term versus just cramming for that block exam.
Yeah, totally. And spaced repetition is super popular now. It's automated in a lot of different apps. We're going to try to include some spaced repetition features, which just means, like, you don't have to memorize every single word on the page. Just go through the information really quickly. And if there's something tough, like, study it sooner, like, repeat, study it again and study it sooner and more often than the stuff that you're, like, more comfortable with. You still need to repeat studying the stuff you're more comfortable with, but just don't repeat study it as often. Like, it's so hard to manage all that. Like, even just saying that is like, how do I organize my slide sets and all my books that way? So we are trying to figure out ways to automate that on our website. Like, you'll see certain sketches or watch certain videos more often if they're harder for you and stuff like that. We also have an app coming out this year that's hopefully we'll be able to put on some spaced repetition features. But yeah, these kind of outside resources are going to be a cool way to test different ways of organizing the info and better learning processes.
Yeah, I think that's one of the beauties of Sketchy Medical, is that it really is built to not necessarily be a strict memory palace, memorize this technique. It's supposed to be a way to get acquainted that you'll ever take through Sketchy Medical, from first and second year classes to now third and fourth year classes and rotations and wards. And if you're on your intern year, it's really a universe to get acquainted with, characters get acquainted with, so that it's built into long-term memory. And it's constantly being re-shown to you because the characters are popping up again and again, just in different situations. And that recall for first and second year topics that involve a lot of maybe pathology and physiology are kind of built in and are always getting re-shown to you a little bit here and there while we're creating this whole new story, which involves actually applying this knowledge.
Yeah, so like when watching our videos, you don't have to watch it, memorize every single little text box that pops up. What I would do is, and what I recommend, is that you watch the video before class just to get into this mindset that you want to be in this Western theme for tuberculosis. Then you go to lecture and they give you more information about what they want you to know about tuberculosis. Then go back to our video and be like, oh yeah, how did my lecture kind of line up with the characters in this video? And you'll totally be able to line it up, make your mind map. And then come back to the video later, do the review card, do the quiz. We have a new cool quiz, all visual quiz feature now. But then get into some more videos, try some farm videos, try some path videos, because you'll see this tuberculosis cactus with the cavitary lesions. It'll keep coming back and you'll be like, oh yeah, I've seen that cactus before. That's cool. And just recognizing the cactus without memorizing all the little details in the different videos is already helping you prepare for step one, where you need to make all these connections of different diseases and drugs and microbes. Just getting to know the characters and noticing when they come back is super helpful in itself, not wasting time trying to memorize every detail.
Mm-hmm. Really getting into the universe and the structure and this big overarching story that we've set up is most important. And it really gets a lot of the overwhelming part of learning out of the way. It'll get a lot of the trying to recall different chunks of information in your brain. It'll get that out of the way for you so that you can then focus on the more important things at hand, which is researching that patient you had to go see the next day or even in the next few minutes, researching some more important medical journals because you're supposed to look up certain topics for morning report or something like that.
And a quick note from today's sponsor.
Hey, it's Patrick from the Inside the Boards podcast with a message from Common Bond, our supporter for this show and the ITB Main podcast and Study Smarter podcast. Today, Pete Wiley's here. He's the VP of Student Lending at Common Bond. Thanks for taking the time, Pete. Just a few questions for you. What should students consider when choosing a loan for their medical education?
You know, the main thing we ask students to consider is the total cost that they expect for the loan that they need. And we've worked with schools and medical and dental students to design a loan that has lower interest rates than the federal Grad Plus loan, so it can lower the total cost of that loan for the student over time. And, you know, the other major consideration is just what they expect to do after medical school. If they're going to go work for a nonprofit hospital, certainly, you know, we would encourage them to continue to take government loans and take advantage of the Public Service Loan Forgiveness Program. But if they know they're not going to work for a nonprofit, I'd really just encourage them to look at the repayment options and the interest rate of their loan, because that determines the total amount they'll pay over time.
Gotcha. And I will say I'm impressed with you guys because of your not only concern for the particular circumstances of medical students and trainees within medicine, but also your company does something for the less fortunate among us. Can you tell me about the Social Promise program?
Sure. For every loan that's funded on the Common Bond platform, we also fund the education of a child in need through our partnership with Pencils of Promise.
Cool. Well, that's awesome. Thanks, Pete. I appreciate the time. Go to commonbond.co/ITB to learn more. Thanks for listening. Back to Chase with the Medical Mnemonist.
There's so many important, more important aspects of medicine. And the whole point the whole point is that Sketchy Medical is there to give you
care of that for you. Yeah. just think of the tuberculosis cavitary cactus and you're good.
And I guess the themes of the videos are something I probably didn't pay too much attention to. I believe Sketchy Micro came out around the time I was at the end of my second year taking Micro, but I'm not sure if I learned about it at the time or after. I don't remember now. So I don't think I really got into the videos as much as some of my classmates did that knew about it sooner than I did. And I'm guessing if you pay more attention to that theme, it'll help you a lot more remembering which visuals go into which scene.
You know, just watch the newest season of Stranger Things and you'll be fine.
Yeah, you'll be good. And you'll be like, oh, that's what they meant by that sketch. I get it.
I don't want to like start some kind of conspiracy theory here, but it's all connected.
Yeah, adding in pop references now too.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I also recommend to understand our videos better. You might need to catch up with Game of Thrones.
It may be a prerequisite. I'm not sure. It might be.
Scleroderma's this dragon lady, and you know, it's pretty helpful to understand the strife and the struggle with the White Walkers. It's pretty. It applies to medicine more than you think.
That's a great sales tactic, because now you have several million Game of Thrones fans that have to consume everything that comes out of Game of Thrones. So now they have to watch your videos
exactly.
on it too.
And they have to buy all the merch.
I had a pathology professor that was just like a White Walker. He was like old and like, you know, kind of like wandering around. And I just knew so much more after seeing that show, you know.
Yeah. We do a lot of fun concepts. So like we'll do video game stuff. We'll do pop culture. We'll do historical stuff. We'll do literary references. And hey, if you guys feel like we missed anything, if we missed your favorite show, just reach out to us.
No, we haven't done an Always Sunny in Philadelphia reference yet. Okay.
No, but that'll be our next Strider differential diagnosis video. I promise.
We'll do like a whole video dedicated to Danny DeVito and his life for one of our next budgets, just for them.
We always need inspiration, so feel free to reach out to us,
guys. I mean, that's one of the fun things of getting into the Sketchy Medical universe is the variety of scenes and how important that was for us to really distinguish different chunks of information and to really make it so there are new emotional attachments and new hilarious narrations and scenes and jokes getting tied to topics that need to be differentiated. I mean, when you can go through a topic in your mind and it sticks because it's so, there's all this emotional memory right there. It's when there's this emotional attachment and you can always go back to that, and then you start remembering. You're like, oh yeah, he made that weird reference to Blade Runner. That was weird. And like, but even something little like that will just like make all these other ideas start flowing. Just go with the flow. It'll start flowing.
I know having an emotional connection or some sort of way to make it personal is really beneficial for long-term memory of especially less interesting topics.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you'd be surprised. Like one of the hardest parts of like thinking on your feet and recalling information is just getting to that part of your brain, like where it's stored. Once you're there, it's like, you know your stuff. Like you've seen it so many times now. You just let it flow, do your thing. The hardest part is often just when you're sitting there going, and you're like, you're not even thinking of anything. You're just like completely blank and you don't even know where to go in your brain.
It's that door in front of you is closed and you can't figure out how to open it.
Just get into a scene, something in your mind, a folder, a page in a book. To get to that is the most important step. After that, it's then you're finally relaxed and you get to show people what you know.
Dude, and you're all about the flow today.
It's a carousel, around and around. Go with the flow. Feel it.
And you guys mentioned the spaced repetition that you're going to add in or have already added in. Do you have a certain algorithm that you follow? I was actually just recording an episode about this earlier, so I'm curious to get your input on what you think is like ideal or if there is such a thing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, honestly, you can do it yourself now. It just takes a lot more kind of organization. Like I would just keep it super, super simple. Like
keep it simple.
It's honestly easier if you have a flashcard deck, because then you can just like shuffle your cards in a way you know will help you learn better. But it's honestly like the videos that are harder for you, just go into your calendar, kind of mark down, I want to watch this video this day. Or
it doesn't have to be a video, it has to be a page or a review card or something.
Right. Or a quiz, like take a quiz on this video this day. And then like, oh, this, like, I know, say, Naegleria fowleri, I'll put that microbe, like, I want to study once this month, put it down on my calendar. And then maybe the next time I get to Naegleria fowleri, if I miss all the quiz questions, like, maybe I'll assign that to, like, once every other week, I should watch this video or look at this review card. So it's honestly easier if there's an algorithm or app that does that for you. But I totally recommend doing that for yourself first, which is something I wish I had done. Like when I was in medical school, I tried to memorize every little detail. Like I wouldn't move on from one page in my slide set until I like memorized everything on that page. But an approach where I would just get the gist and move on to the next slide and get the gist. And the slides that I had a hard time getting the gist for, I'd look at more often. Like I would totally space it out more and totally not get caught up in the details.
Yeah. I know I didn't. Even though I had heard about spaced repetition and did a little research on it before med school through my educational psychology degree, I only read about it. I didn't know how to put it into practice. So I actually didn't realize that what I was doing during med school was completely wrong and didn't help at all.
I know, same here. But I mean, it's tough because it's like, hey guys, remember all this stuff. I'm like, okay, oh geez, okay, I'll just start on the page one. I'll memorize through page 100.
And there are a lot of study habits you learn in undergrad that are hard to get out of once you've been doing it for so long.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of bad habits.
Yeah. But we're going to start integrating some stuff. If you guys have ideas on how you would want us to organize our videos in different ways, like totally reach out to us and give us your ideas, because we're down to...
No, we just sit here reading fan mail all day. Not fan mail being hate mail.
How we don't have more videos released. because we're totally down to help you guys structure the videos in certain ways or make it easier for you guys to watch the videos in certain orders and stuff like that. And we're working on it. We're going to add more cool features like that.
Cool. Well, then before I let you guys go, I'd like to finish it off with a walk down memory lane, how I end most episodes.
Oh, that's nice. That's cute.
So are you ready to take a walk with me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How far back are we going? It's like baby times.
As far back as you want. No, it's three rapid questions. Answer in as much or little detail as you like. Oh, so
man, rapid fire.
The first one,
Jeopardy right now.
The first one is just, is there anything you wish you could remember better?
Wow. I always forget. I have a 2-year-old daughter at home. I always forget like I, every month I have to remind myself, when is her birthday? Like, when was she born again? Cause I can't ask anyone, right? I can't ask my wife. I look like an idiot. And so I have to figure it out myself. I'm like, oh my God, May. And then luckily someone in the office, her daughter is like exactly a week older than my daughter. So thankfully I finally figured out a way to remember. I just ask her, but
dude, I'm a new father. I have a 2-month-old, my first child.
See, I'm the older twin. So I had a baby first.
Exactly. It was not 20 minutes. It was like 1 year apart. But that is so, I'm kind of changing my answer. That is so true.
So
like,
true, right?
My wife will be like, oh, she's turning 16 weeks today. And I'll be like, six, how did you remember it down to the week? Like the number of, she's like, how do you not know she's 3 months old? I'll be like,
I was talking
geez.
To Sabina there. She was like, oh, Sophie's 7,126 minutes old today. And I was like, what are you talking about? How do you know this? And I just go, yeah, you're right.
You need to set like a repeating weekly meeting in your Google, you know, Google calendar or something.
Yeah, I know exactly where she is right now. She's at the, you know, play place.
Yeah, we don't lose track of them. So at least we got that down.
She's at the thing. That's wow, I'm going to look like a bad father now.
Hey, I mean, if
this is not where this question was supposed to go.
No. I could put a medical spin on it, though. Like, I think it's really cool.
Like,
because
she went to the hospital.
No. Like, a positive medical spin on this.
Oh, got it.
Like, when we're creating the courses and stuff, like, I almost know more, and I'm so sad that I didn't know some of this stuff. I know more now about step one than I did back when I was studying for step one. But it's tough because you're, like, in it, and you don't have time. You're just trying to take everything in. But it's cool now, like, kind of like it works. Like, I do remember that stuff, but it's because I go over it day in and day out.
Yeah, and you have a better practice for it, and you don't have the pressure of needing to take the stupid exam.
Exactly. So
there are certain pressures of having a startup, running your own business, for sure.
Feel
ton of pressure, but it's not, you're not like there to quickly memorize a farm course, that's for sure. It's a little different. To be completely honest, I do know so much more about, say, pharmacology than I did in my second year of medical school when I was pretty much there to sit there and memorize things. I think it just really points towards getting into a universe, getting into a style, getting acquainted with...
Don't you agree too, though? Like, since then you've kind of taken more of a step back and like, oh, how do all these drugs relate to each other? Like, what side effects should I draw on each one?
Exactly.
Like, something that we kind of should have done in medical school. So it's not too late.
thinking like, broadly, thinking how things connect to each other across topics makes it stick. And it makes it so every time it comes back, you're like, oh yeah, that thing. And you just remember its backstory. Yes, every single time you see it, all the other information about it is also reinforced.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like it's its own repetition. Even though it looks like it's new, it's not. And then a lot of pointers that we get from when we talk to residents specifically is that you kind of have to undo everything you learned in medical school because it's kind of backwards. In medical school, you start with physiology. You then move on to specific topics like how physiology relates to pharmacology and PATH, and then internal medicine and all the other wards materials. And then once you get to residency, it's like, hey, remember physiology? Yeah, you have to know exactly what kind of physiological problem is happening with every single patient you have. And you're like, oh, what? I have to remember the first week of medical school. I remembered everything but that. I remembered all the drug names. Has low blood pressure, and you have to know exactly why, not what the disease name is. And so you really have to go back to the basics when you're a residency. You have to go back to physiology. And so
isn't it so sad? That's like a complete spin. They spin it on you. Forget the physiology is learned. It's not, I spin it back. It's like, here, what's the physiology? Make sure this patient doesn't die. Forget the disease name.
But this is why it's so important to constantly be applying a certain idea across topics.
And broadly.
All the way from physiology, all the way down to a specific disease.
Are we wandering off of memory lane right now?
Oh, we were far off of memory lane. We went into the woods a while back, but it's all right. Actually, I really like this topic. So
I saw something shiny, so I was like, ooh, and I just like went over there.
It's actually a great point because I always thought like step two material probably should have been first. If you learned all the, you know, diagnostic tests and treatments and stuff a little bit more ahead of time, then you might recognize the patient script a little bit better than just kind of getting these bits and pieces and basic science aspects that are like PhD requirements and not really necessary to know at that stage. And
honestly, it's popular. It's pretty popular education organization scheme that some schools are switching to. I know some schools already combine first and second year into 1 year so that you can focus on the more clinical stuff earlier. Some schools are considering moving step one till after wards, even so that you can apply the knowledge you learned first before you get tested on it.
Oh, I like that.
And I think it's pretty cool to think of different ways to organize, because there's always a better way to do it. So let's try some new styles. It's always a better way to do it. So true.
Mm-hmm. Test out what actually works and not just what you want to work.
Yep.
All right. Question number two, getting back on the path here.
Rapid fire. Yes. Very rapid. It's like Family Feud. The mall.
So number two, you've answered some of this already, but if you want to add any more detail or think of something else, is there anything looking back now that you would have changed about your school training, how you approached it?
No, I think we pretty much touched upon it. Just don't get lost in the details. Take a broader kind of point of view to make connections between the material first, then go back and get the details down, I think is totally the way to go. And it's something I'll admit I did not do. And yeah, I did okay, but it would have been less stressful if I'd taken that approach.
Yep. When you learn something in pathology, tie it to pharmacology, tie it back to physiology and microbiology, tie it all together. That way, whenever you encounter it, doesn't matter what setting you're in. And can't stress this kind of like visual learning. My brother and I, of course, are just, you know, kind of biased right now, but we're just big proponents of visual learning and to give yourself something to think about, like something to go back to. If visual learning to you is just straight up photographic memory, and I want to like try to memorize this textbook page, as long as there's something to go back to in your brain, and then from there, all the information is there, and you can like work through it and figure out problems.
Good. Yeah. Visual learning, spaced repetition, and doing it the correct way, not the way I did it, and integration.
Not the way I did it. Isn't that a great tip? Oh, I know. Do it the correct way. That'll help.
I should just basically write a book saying the way I did it, and then do the opposite. Yeah.
It's more of a pamphlet. You know? Smart choose your own adventure, and you don't choose his like choices.
Yeah. I say that on like every episode. Don't do it the way I did it.
It's good advice.
Now, last one is there anything you wish you did differently in your, well, I guess your side gig would be the one remaining since you didn't go into clinical practice. Sometimes I ask that one, and we already covered some of the medical school ones. So how about with building Sketchy as you did, or maybe the year off doing research?
Yeah, totally. I mean,
is this your side gig, Bryan?
Yeah, let's do the side gig.
This is his gig. Bryan's the headliner. He's like the...
We totally made mistakes during the startup phase of our project, this whole Sketchy universe we're building. And like some people that were used to be on the team aren't on the team anymore. Like certain material we were going to cover and spent a long time on, we kind of put on the back burner and moved over to new topics. But I wouldn't take that away. Like, I think learning from mistakes is really important. And I think that all that helped us get to where we are now. And I think it's all been worth it. And I wouldn't tell anyone to be afraid of making mistakes, because it'll all work out in the end as long as you're doing something you really like to do.
Good.
And but you know what? We made this. There's one of our pathology videos CNS tumors. And I wanted to do a Star Trek theme because I thought it'd be just hilarious, like deep space where no metastasis have gone before.
Yeah. And then the way it's always some like homage to a topic, not so using Star Trek.
So I know it's popular, but I've actually never watched Star Trek. So to do a lot of research in order to build this
make. You're on the wiki page, like going,
what's this wrinkly forehead guy? He looks like, you know, he looks like this brain tumor. I want him to be a character, but what is he?
I mean, I've seen like 1.5 episodes of The Next Generation.
So you've seen one?
And we all know who Patrick Stewart, like, you know, we all know
his Professor Xavier to me.
That's true.
Anyways, as long as he's bald, he's recognizable. But
Picard meme.
Yeah, exactly. We've seen the Picard meme. Yeah. Memes. There are multiple of that guy.
Yeah. So honestly, I think we include some of those, like those Picard references in the script. Yeah. Anyways, we'll show it to you later. You check it. I think you'll laugh.
Yeah, definitely.
But I wish I had gotten into Star Trek sooner so that it was easier for me to make that video later.
That's really your big take. I wish I had gotten into Star Trek sooner.
Yeah, that would have been a really good career move for me.
I've heard
he's back.
Yeah, exactly.
He has a show again.
It's time for me to do all the research again so I make one more Star Trek video.
All over again.
It's going to take 2 months for me to make this video.
All over again.
I'll just binge watch one of them. Gosh, I should watch some. You know, we did a Doctor Who themed one too, and I was like, that I had seen a couple episodes of. So I was like, I can make some Doctor Who references. It's multiple sclerosis because time and space.
It's a spinoff. It was called like Doctor What or something. I forget. What
nice.
It was like Doctor something.
I didn't get to show you my tattoo before we had to cut the video out, but I'll show you that sometime.
Dude, you got to watch the multiple sclerosis video. You're gonna dig it. Totally dig it.
Nice.
I had to do 2 months of research to make it, but you'll love it.
Just researching Doctor Who, not multiple sclerosis.
Wow. It's kind of a combo, I guess.
Well,
I wish I had watched Doctor Who sooner. And that would have been an awesome career move.
Not helping medical students.
That would have really boosted my career.
Sci-fi stuff, you can just reach out to me. I'm probably going to be a good researcher.
Oh, awesome. Dang. Yeah, what's your favorite sci-fi movie?
Oh, I really don't pick favorites. I can't, but...
He has a tattoo of Doctor Who. What the heck?
I don't pick favorites. I just get tattoos of things I kind of would like.
I'll go into more details later.
How many tattoos is Carhartt? Kind of enjoys a lot of things. Illustrated man over here. Like, yeah, I kind of like things, I guess.
I think we should just assume it's Doctor Who since... Yeah. Anyways, we'll show you that video later. You're going to love it.
Awesome. I'll have you guys draw me up my future tattoo or something.
Totally could. That'd be so funny.
Yeah.
I hope he has like a 16x9 just like section on his back available.
Because you get a whole differential diagnosis for dizziness.
Oh boy.
Oh, yeah, like right pain, there. So the doctor like...
Right now.
You know, I think we're still, I'm not going to lie, I think we're still just right on memory lane.
Yeah, we're good.
Because this is, you know, we're just traipsing around.
All right, then we'll end it here with any last minute thoughts, any last minute projects. I know you said the space repetition and the clinical medicine stuff is coming out, which should be very interesting. And then any social media or other ways for students to find you?
Yeah, you can find us on Facebook and Instagram. I think Instagram's our favorite because it's super visual. And we even have these cool visual questions of the week that you can interact with. You don't have to worry about getting them right. Just interacting with them is really fun. And we update those all the time. And our website is obviously www.sketchymedical.com.
Yep.
But the coolest thing we're building is more step two and more clinical stuff.
We started our nursing course. Right now it's just pharmacology because pharmacology is extremely important for nursing. And I remember all the nurses knew it better than me by the time I was talking about pharmacology. And we're also just have other projects in the works. We're just like always thinking about how we can apply it to new information.
Yeah, so check us out on Facebook and Instagram. We'll keep you guys updated.
Nice.
And make sure you watch the new season of Stranger Things. I guarantee you there'll be some references in the new videos we
make. Totally. We're going to have some hair metal in there. It's going to be great.
We're totally going to have hair metal in there. Dude, Def Lep. That's what I'm talking about.
Doctors Bryan and Aaron Lemieux, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Yeah, thank you for having us. It was an awesome time.
We hope you enjoyed this episode. For links to connect to us, email us, or for previous episodes, please see the show notes. We'd also love to hear from you, so please send an email or join us on the Medical Nemesis Mastermind Facebook group. Any ideas, tips, tricks, people that you'd like to hear interviewed, we'd love to hear it. Any advice to make the show better and more enjoyable would be greatly appreciated.
One last thing before we end today's episode. All of the links and discount codes available through today's show will be available in the show notes. You can enter that in your podcast app or by going to medicalnemonist.podbean.com. That will include our 15% discount for Sketchy Medical. Thank you, guys. Our Common Bond sponsorship. Our Pay My USMLE giveaway hosted by Inside the Boards. Yes, we'll pay for your board exam. So click that link, find out how to enter. It's only going on for a few more weeks, so get on that quick. Also, our new podcast, Physiology by Physio. There will be a 25% discount for your physio subscription if you choose to use that. So get the links, get the discounts. If you can't find anything, shoot us a message. We'd be happy to guide you further. All right, catch you on the next show.